A Horse and Two Goats, a story by R.K. Narayan. Of the 700,000 villages dotting the map of India, Kritam was probably the tiniest, indicated by a microscopic dot. It meant in Tamil, coronet or crown on the brow of the subcontinent. The village consisted of less than 30 houses, one of them built with brick and cement. Painted a brilliant yellow and blue all over with gorgeous carvings of gods and gargoyles on its balustrade, it was known as the Big House. The other houses, distributed in four streets, were generally of bamboo thatch, straw, mud, and other unspecified materials. In his prosperous days, Muni had owned a flock of 40 sheep and goats and sallied forth every morning driving the flock to the highway a couple of miles away. He also gathered fagots and dry sticks, bundled them and carried them home for fuel at sunset. His wife lit the domestic fire at dawn, boiled water in a mud pot, threw it into a handful of millet flour, added salt, and gave him his first nourishment for the day. His fortunes had declined gradually, unnoticed. From a flock of 40 which he drove into a pen at night, his stock had now come down to the two goats which were tethered to the trunk of a drumstick tree which grew in front of his hut and from which, occasionally, Muni could shake down drumsticks. This morning he got six. He carried them in with a sense of triumph. Although no one could say precisely who owned the tree, it was his because he lived in its shadow. His wife said, "If you were content with the drumstick leaves alone, I could boil and salt some for you." "Oh, I'm tired of eating those leaves. I have a craving to chew the drumstick out of sauce, I tell you." "You have only four teeth in your jaw, but your craving is for big things." "All right, get the stuff for the sauce and I'll prepare it for you. After all, next year you may not be alive to ask for anything. But first get me all the stuff, including a measure of rice or millet, and I will satisfy your unholy craving. Our store is empty today. Dal, chili, curry leaves, mustard, coriander, gingerly oil, and one large potato. Go out and get all this." He repeated the list after her in order not to miss any item and walked off to the shop in the third street. Muni sat patiently on an upturned packing case below the platform of the shop. The shopman paid no attention to him. Muni kept clearing his throat, coughing and sneezing until the shopman could not stand it anymore and demanded, "What ails you, young man? You will fly off that seat into the gutter if you sneeze so hard, young man." Muni laughed inordinately in order to please the shopman at being called a young man. By thus humouring the shopman, Muni could always ask for one or two items of food, promising repayment later. The shopman said, "If you could find 5 rupees and a quarter, you will have paid off an ancient debt. How much have you got now?" "I will pay you everything on the first of the next month." "As always, and whom do you expect to rob by then?" Muni felt caught and mumbled, "My daughter has sent word that she will be sending me money soon." "Have you a daughter?" sneered the shopman. "And she is sending you money. For what purpose, may I know?" "Birthday, 50th birthday," said Muni quietly. "Birthday? How old are you?" Muni repeated weakly, not being sure of it himself. 50. He always calculated his age from the time of the great famine when he stood as high as the parapet around the village well. But who could calculate such thing accurately nowadays with so many famines occurring? The shopman felt encouraged when other customers stood around to watch and comment. "More likely you are 70, he said to Muni. "You also forgot that you mentioned a birthday 5 weeks ago when you wanted castor oil for your holy bath." At this, Muni unobtrusively rose and moved off. He later told his wife, "That scoundrel would not give me anything. So go out and sell the drumsticks for what they are worth." He flung himself down in a corner to recoup from the fatigue of his visit to the shop. His wife said, "You are getting no sauce today, nor anything else. I can't find anything to give you to eat. Fast till the evening, it will do you good." "Take the goats and be gone now," she cried, and added, "Don't come back before the sun is down." He knew that if he obeyed her, she would somehow conjure up some food for him in the evening, only he must be careful not to argue and irritate her. She was sure to go out and work, grind corn in the big house, sweep or scrub somewhere, and earn enough to buy his foodstuff and keep a dinner ready for him in the evening. He passed through the village with his head bowed in thought. He did not want to look at anyone or be accosted. The shopman had said that he was 70. At 70, one only waited to be summoned by God. When he was dead, what would his wife do? There was no progeny with them. Only on the outskirts did he lift his head and look up. He urged and bullied the goats until they meandered along to the foot of the horse statue on the edge of the village. He sat on its pedestal for the rest of the day. The advantage of this was that he could watch the highway and see the lorries and buses pass through to the hills, and it gave him a sense of belonging to a larger world. The horse was nearly life-size, molded out of clay, baked, burnt and brightly colored, and reared its head proudly, prancing its four legs in the air and flourishing its tail in a loop. Beside the horse stood a warrior with scythe-like mustachios, bulging eyes and aquiline nose. The horse itself was said to have been as white as dhobi-washed seat, and had had on its back a cover of pure brocade of red and black lace, matching the multicolored sash around the waist of the warrior. This statue had been made closer to the population of the village at one time, when this spot bordered the village. He must give her time to cool off her temper and feel sympathetic, and then she would scrounge and manage to get some food for him. Today, while he observed the yellow vehicle coming down, he was wondering how to describe it later to his wife when it sputtered and stopped in front of him. A red-faced foreigner who had been driving it got down and went round it. He straightened himself up, looked at the dashboard and stared in Muni's direction, and approached him. "Excuse me, is there a gas station nearby, or do I have to wait until another car comes?" He suddenly looked up at the clay horse and cried, "Marvelous!" without completing his sentence. The red-faced man wore khaki clothes, evidently a policeman or a soldier. Muni said to himself, "He will chase or shoot if I start running. Some dogs chase only those who run. Oh Shiva, protect me. I don't know why this man should be after me." Meanwhile, the foreigner cried, "Marvelous!" again, nodding his head. He paced around the statue with his eyes fixed on it. He pressed his palms together, smiled and said, "Namaste, how do you do?" At which Muni spoke the only English expressions he had learned: "Yes, no." Having exhausted his English vocabulary, he started in Tamil. "My name is Muni. These two goats are mine and no one can gainsay it. Though our village is full of slanderers these days who will not hesitate to say that what belongs to a man does not belong to him." Suddenly remembering the courtesies of the season, he asked, "Do you smoke?" Muni again replied the same expression, "Yes, no." He had always wanted to smoke a cigarette. Only once did the shopman give him one on credit, and he remembered how good it had tasted. Muni felt so confused about how to act that he blew on it and put it out. Muni drew a deep puff and started coughing. It was racking, no doubt, but extremely pleasant. No need to run away from a man who gave him such a potent smoke. "I come from New York," took out a wallet from his hip pocket and presented his card in order to give him the introduction. Muni shrank away from the card. "Beware of khaki," one part of his mind warned. "Take all the cigarettes or whatever is offered, but don't get caught. Beware of the khaki." At 71, he didn't run but surrendered to what came. He said, "Before God, sir, Bhagwan, who sees everything, I tell you, sir, that we know nothing of the case. If the murder was committed, whoever did it will not escape. Bhagwan is all-seeing. Don't ask me about it. I know nothing." Muni added an explanation. "Anything is possible there, sir. People over there will stop at nothing." "I'm sure you know when this horse was made," said the red man and smiled ingratiatingly. Muni reacted to the relaxed atmosphere by smiling himself and pleaded, "Please go away, sir. I know nothing. I promise we will hold him for you if we see any bad character around. And we'll bury him up to his neck in a coconut pit if he tries to escape. But our village has always had a clean record. Must definitely be the people of other village. Now the red man implored, please, please, I'll speak slowly. Please try to understand me. Can't you understand even a simple word of English? Everyone in this country seems to know English. I've gotten along with the English everywhere in this country, but you don't speak it. Have you any religious or spiritual scruples against English speech? Muni made some indistinct sounds and in his throat and shook his head. You see, last August, we probably had the hottest summer in history, and I was working in short sleeves in my office on the 40th floor of the Empire State Building. We had a power failure one day, you know, and there I was stuck for 4 hours, no elevator and no air conditioning. All the way in train, I kept thinking, and the minute I reached home in Connecticut, I told my wife Ruth, we'll visit India this winter. It's time to look at other civilizations. Next day, she called the travel agent first thing and told him to fix it, and so here I am. Ruth came with me but is staying back at Srinagar, and I am the one doing rounds and joining her later. Muni looked reflective at the end of this long oration and said rather feebly, yes, no, as a concession to the other's language, and went on in Tamil. When I was this high, he indicated a foot high. I heard my uncle say, no one can tell what was he planning to say, as the other interrupted at this stage to ask, boy, what is the secret of your teeth? How old are you? Muni forgot what he had started to say and remarked, sometimes we too lose our cattle. Jackals or cheetahs may sometimes carry them off. But sometimes it is just theft from over in the next village, and then we'll know who has done it. Our priest at the temple can see in the camphor flame the face of the thief, and when he is caught, he gestured with his hands a perfect mincing of meat. The American washed his hands intently and said, I know what you mean. Chop something? Maybe I am holding you up and you want to chop wood? Where is your axe? Hand it to me and show me what to chop. I do enjoy it, you know, just a hobby. We get a lot of driftwood along the backwater near my house. And on Sundays, I do nothing but chop wood for the fireplace. I really feel different when I watch the fire in the fireplace, although it may take all the sections of the Sunday New York Times to get a fire started. And he smiled at this reference. Muni felt totally confused, but decided the best thing would be to make an attempt to get away from this place. He tried to edge out, saying, must go home, and turned to go. The other seized his shoulder and said despairingly, is there no one, absolutely no one here to translate for me? He looked up and down the road, which was deserted in this hot afternoon. The stranger almost pinned Muni's back to the statue and asked, isn't this statue yours? Why don't you sell it to me? The old man now understood the reference to the horse and thought for a second and said in his own language, I was an urchin this high when I heard my grandfather explain this horse and warrior. And my grandfather himself was this high when he heard his grandfather, whose grandfather? The other man interrupted him. I don't want to seem to have stopped here for nothing. I'll offer you a good price for this, he said, indicating the horse. Perhaps he guessed by the way he sat on its pedestal. Muni followed the man's eyes and pointing fingers and dimly understood that the subject matter was the horse, and feeling relieved that the theme of the mutilated body had been abandoned, at least for the time being, said again enthusiastically, I was this high when my grandfather told me about this horse and the warrior, and my grandfather was this high when he himself. The Tamil that Muni spoke was stimulating, even as pure sound, and the foreigner listened with fascination. I wish I had my tape recorder here, he said, assuming the pleasantest expression. Your language sounds wonderful. I get a kick out of every word you utter here. He indicated his ears. But you don't have to waste your breath in sales talk. I appreciate the article. You don't have to explain its points. Muni said, I never went to a school. In those days, only Brahmin went to schools. But we had to go out and work in the fields morning till night, from sowing to harvest time. And when Pongal came, we had cut the harvest. My father allowed me to go out and play with others at the tank. And so I don't know the Firangi language you speak. Even little fellows in your country probably speak the Firangi language. But here only learned men and officers know it. The foreigner laughed heartily. Taking out another cigarette and offered it to Muni, who now smoked with ease. The American now stood up and said, running his finger along some of the carved decorations around the horse neck, speaking slowly and uttering his words syllable by syllable. I could give a sales talk for this better than anyone else. This is a marvelous combination of yellow and indigo, though faded now. How do you people of this country achieve these flaming colors? Muni now assumed that the subject was still the horse and not the dead body, said, this is our guardian. It means death to our adversaries. At the end of Kali Yuga, this world and all other worlds will be destroyed. And the Redeemer, the great Redeemer, will come in the shape of a horse called Kalki. This horse will come to life and gallop and trample down all the bad men. The foreigner utilized the pause to say, I assure you that this will have the best home in USA. I'll push away the bookcase. You know, I love books and I'm a member of 5 book clubs as well. And the choice and bonus volumes mount up to a pile really in our living room, as high as this horse itself. But they'll have to go. Ruth may disapprove, but I'll convince Muni, continued his description of the end of the world. A pundit discoursed at the temple once how the oceans are going to close over the earth in a huge wave and swallow us. This horse will grow bigger than the biggest wave and carry on its back only the good people and kick into the floods the evil ones. Plenty of them about, he said reflectively. The foreigner now understood by the tone of the other that a question was being asked and said, I am not a millionaire but a modest businessman. My trade is coffee. Amidst all the wilderness, he caught the word coffee and said, if you want to drink coffee, drive further up in the next town, they have Friday market and there they open coffee hotels. So I learned from passerbys. The foreigner said, I repeat, I am not a millionaire. Ours is a modest business. After all, we can't afford to buy more than 60 minutes of TV time in a month, which works out to 2 minutes a day. That's all. Although in the course of time, we may be sponsored a one-hour show regularly if our sales graph continues to go up. The visitor, feeling that he had spent too much time already, said, tell me, will you accept 100 rupees or not for the horse? I'd love to take the whiskered soldier also, but no space for him this year. I'll have to cancel my air ticket and take a boat home, I suppose. Ruth can go by air if she likes, but I'll go with the horse and keep him in my cabin all the way if necessary. I have my station wagon as you see. I can push the seat back and take the horse in if you will just lend me a hand with it. Lend me a hand, I can give lift off the horse from its pedestal after picking out the cement at the joints. We can do anything if we have a basis of understanding. Muni said, O Honorable One, I hope God has blessed you with numerous progeny. I say this because you seem to be a good man, willing to stay beside an old man and talk to him, while all day I have none to talk except when somebody stops by to ask for a piece of tobacco. Noting the other's interest in his speech, Muni felt encouraged to ask, how many children have you? With appropriate gestures with his hands, he replied, I said, 100. How many boys are there and how many girls? Where are they? Is your daughter married? Is it difficult to find a son-in-law in your country also? As it is here. He flourished a 100-rupee currency note and said, well, this is what I meant. The old man now realized that some financial element was entering their talk. He said with a grin, ask our village headman who is also a money lender. He can change even 1 lakh rupees in gold sovereigns if you prefer it that way. He thinks nobody knows, but dig the floor of his puja room and your head will reel at the sight of the hoard. The man disguises himself in rags just to mislead the people. Talk to the headman yourself because he goes mad at the sight of me. I don't know why. The foreigner followed his look and decided that it would be a sound policy to show an interest in the old man's pets. Now the truth dawned on the old man. His dream of a lifetime was about to be realized. The animals were not prize ones for a cattle show, but he had spent his occasional savings to provide them some fancy diet now and then, and they did not look too bad. The red man left on his palm 100 rupees in tens now, suddenly realizing that this was what the old man was asking. It is all for you, or you may share it if you have a partner. The old man pointed at the station wagon and asked, are you carrying them off in that?
Yes, of course, said the other, understanding the transportation part of it. The old man said, this will be their first ride in a motor car. Carry them off after I get out of sight. Otherwise, they will never follow you, but only me if I am travelling on the path to Yamlok. He laughed at his own joke and exited. The red man looked at the goats grazing peacefully. He ruminated. He must be gone to fetch some help, I suppose, and settled down to wait. When a truck came downhill, he stopped it and got the help of a couple of men to detach the horse from its pedestal and place it in his station wagon. He gave them 5 rupees each, and for a further payment, they siphoned off gas from the truck and helped him to start his engine. Muni hurried homeward with the cash securely tucked away at his waist in his dhoti. She snatched the notes from him, counted them by the glow of the fire, and said, 100 rupees? How did you come by it? Have you been stealing? I've sold our goats to a red-faced man. He was absolutely crazy to have them. Gave me all this money and carried them off in his motor car. Hardly had these words left his lips when they heard bleating outside. She opened the door and saw the two goats at her door. Here they are, she said. What's the meaning of all this? He muttered a great curse and seized one of the goats by its ears and shouted, Where is that man? Don't you know you are his? Why did you come back? The goat only wriggled in his grip. He asked the same question of the other two. The goat shook itself off. His wife glared at him and declared, If you have thieved, the police will come tonight and break your bones. Don't involve me. I'll go away to my parents. Thank you so much.